Hello, everybody. It is 10:36 p.m. Central Time on the 20th of May, 2017. It's Saturday going into Sunday, and I'm probably the most frustrated I've been in a while. Oh, Windows update. Oh, shut me all down. Everything got messed up. Everything. You may even notice a difference in the way the screen looks. I think we're either running in a higher resolution or a lower. I can't tell. Everything looks a little bit jagged. Looks like I'm going to have to go in and set up my video card again. Everything got changed. Man, all right. So hope you guys are doing good. Welcome into the Earthquake 3D live stream. Although we're getting a late start tonight, we're still going to be able to run down the earthquakes that struck throughout the day today. And if you're new here, we normally don't have this kind of technical difficulties. I mean, we might have a few, but tonight has been an overwhelming, just, you know, a cluster, if you will, of circumstances. All right, let's jump into it. Let's look at the earthquakes that struck since last night. Now, you may remember we told you guys last night that everywhere where we saw 4.0 activity, we'd be seeing 5.0 activity. And everywhere where we saw 5.0 activity, we might see 6.0 activity. Well, right now, we're kind of in between both forecasts, right in the West Pacific and in the East Pacific. Let's get into it. So, up at Japan, 5.0 activity struck, 4.9s, but we'll call them 5s on both sides of Hokkaido. That's two 5s. That's taking us into the mid-range 5 level. Going down around the deep earthquake itself, the deep earthquake from yesterday, the deep 6, immediately a swarm or a bunch of 5s started to pop up around the location. Now, USGS is not reporting all the earthquakes, but they are reporting a few more than they did a day ago. Over to the east, we're also seeing 5.0 activity, each one of these downgraded to 4.9 or striking at 4.9 directly. As we get up towards Alaska, we go into the 4.0 level, but the largest earthquakes of the day striking in our warned location at Mexico. Now, Mexico topped out at 5.7 and 5.8 on both sides of Colima and Popocatépetl. And we were expecting that. We were expecting 5.0 activity in Mexico. We named Mexico yesterday. Down to the south, down at the South Sandwich Islands, also 5.0 activity, which we talked about. Nobody really lives there, but we did warn for it. It did strike. Up in Europe, check this out, guys. Cyprus was hit. Crete was hit. All were hit by the expected magnitude. Cyprus hit by a 4.0. Crete was hit by a 4.1. See this right here? So we named Cyprus. It was hit directly. Right next to Crete, also hit by a 4.1 and 4.2. If you add those together, that goes to 4.3. So you can check off Cyprus, you can check off Crete, and you can also check off Iceland. Iceland was hit as well. We talked about Iceland yesterday. We talked about the 4.3 that had struck in Romania, and we said a similar sized earthquake would strike in Iceland, right? Right? I mean, so here you go. Here's the 4.3 in Romania, and lo and behold, there is a 4.3 at our X marks the spot in Iceland. It's not a shock. Shouldn't be anybody who's been paying attention. You should understand that's a regular occurrence. Also today, there were new deep earthquakes. I think you can see those here on the screen here right now. 4.6, 4.4, and another semi-deep 4.4. That's on top of yesterday's deep 5.9. At this point, we are in the middle of a deep earthquake event. This is no exaggeration. Whenever we see multiple deep earthquakes like this, we certainly have to watch for larger movement, at least 1 to 2 magnitudes larger than the largest of the bunch. So here we are. You see a 5.9 over here, or deep 6. That means we are looking at the 7 range, maybe even larger, to develop this week in the next 6 days. So I put out a warning last night telling everybody, global unrest taking place, have a plan. It's in the title of the video. I'm not exaggerating. We're looking at the threat of large earthquakes this week based upon our deep earthquake activity over here in the West Pacific. This plays into other locations, even fairly far away from the deep earthquakes themselves, like down in New Zealand. Down in New Zealand, yesterday's 4 on the North Island, followed today by a 4 down at the south tip of the island. So it looks like the 4 on the north part of the island may be all she wrote when it comes to 5.0 activity to the north part of the island, 4 to 5.0 activity on the north part of the island. It may be a miss for me on the Kermadec here north of the catcher's mitt, because we have now been struck down to the south by a similar sized earthquake within 0.1 of the one on the North Island. So that all happened in the last day. Take a look at the smaller earthquakes, and it just kind of tells the tale of, again, that the North Island is under serious stress surrounding two different volcanoes at this point. And, of course, you guys all know about Taupo Volcano, but we need to show you the other one that this was brought to my attention by Chrissy in chat, and I think Tasha as well, but Chrissy was talking about it, which is right, let's see, where is it? Rupahu. Okay, I'm butchering it, but there it is. Okay, this volcano right here has started to show swarm activity. And I'd like to remind everybody that Taranaki started to show swarm activity a couple weeks ago before Taupo got hit. So these volcanoes start to show swarm activity, but I don't think we're looking at an eruption anytime soon. This will be released via seismic pressure first. It would take a tremendous amount of deep activity to get those volcanoes going again. So we're not talking about an eruption, but you are seeing a swarm there. It's because the magma chambers are being perturbed at the north part of the island. Pressure's coming up from down below. Now you have a new swarm of fours up to your north. Guess what? You're about to get multiple 4.0 earthquakes at the central part of the island again. This could go all the way down to Christchurch at this point. Christchurch is swarming out again. So Christchurch is swarming. You get down here to the south, of course, it's pretty obvious. So swarms around the area down to the south plus the 4.0 means new earthquakes are getting ready to strike in the next few days. So when you see like something like this up to your north, it should let you know mid-range fours are coming to the central part of the island in the next few days. And then we also might be looking at 5.0 activity in between the deep earthquakes and New Zealand in the Kermadec. I'm not going to fully discount that yet. It just might be taking an extra day to 2 days to happen. Overall, we need to talk about a few other things before we get out of the West Pacific. That's what's going on up here in North India. With the 4.0 earthquake striking in North India, we told you about that yesterday, hitting in the warned area. Guys, there's a sign that there's pressure actually starting to build in the India, Pakistan, Afghanistan region. You can't forget the 6.0 that struck over in Iran, injuring 200 people, killing 3 people, and now, of course, India. Well, what's right in between there? India and Iran, sandwiched in between Pakistan and Afghanistan, where our deep earthquakes are. Well, if you go look at the other activity that's been coming across, it's centered around there. So only one earthquake, I think, struck in Nepal over the past week and a half. That means this is our go spot here. And it's being bypassed all the way across Myanmar with just fours. What's causing all this activity here? Whenever we see big activity over here in Sumatra, like big eruptions, or earthquake activity in the 5.0 range. What's been happening in the past few days? Volcanic eruptions at Mount Sinabung. Go over and take a look at the volcanic eruption feed. It's a little smaller today than it was yesterday, but all the same suspects are on the list again. So discrete eruption to flight level 200. Discrete up to 200? Guys, flight level 200 is 20,000 feet. Okay, so then we again go up the list. You'll see several of the same volcanoes, Ibu, Manam, Sinabung, Bagana, and then on the eastern side, Reventador and Sabankaya and Turrialba. So let's show you where those are. Well, those are. Sinabung is right here. We get over to the east. We get to Lengila and Bagana and Manam volcanoes located in eastern Papua New Guinea in between these two sets of earthquakes. Then we get up to the north, Sakurajima here. And you get further up to the north. Oh, I'm sorry. Dukono and Ibu here. And then Sakurajima is here. And Shivalush and Kluchevskoy at the Kamchatka Peninsula are up here. So it's equal distance spaced volcanic eruptions across the entire West Pacific at this point, with multiple blasts at each location over the past few days. Well, I told you guys, where we saw fours, they're going to be going to fives. Where we saw fives, we're going to be going to sixes. Well, we're almost there in Mexico already, and we're looking for Central America to get struck by a similar sized earthquake to what struck over to here. So if we see a 5.9 to 6.0 over here deep, we also have to watch for up to a 6.0 over in the East Pacific. Like I said, Central America. So here we are, and we're at almost 6. It's within a point of each other, guys. A similar-sized earthquake on both sides of the Pacific within a day of each other. It shouldn't be too shocking. But the area to the south is now going to get hit. Ironically, Reventador, right here, this where letter V is, Reventador volcano erupting. Turrialba erupting right here in Costa Rica, and then going down to the south in Peru, 5.0 activity also accompanying that down to the south at Sabancaya. So this area, I already warned it yesterday, still under warning tonight. South Ecuador, North Peru has to watch for two different things to happen. First of all, this new round of deep earthquakes over here, that's going to be pushing in on our arrow, going right into Ecuador and maybe Colombia, but most likely Ecuador. And you take into account that this is also the halfway point where the volcano's erupting, it means there's tremendous pressure in this location. There aren't any earthquakes. There's a few eruptions. Tremendous pressure in northern South America or South Central America is never good. It usually results in sizable earthquakes. So what I want you to be prepared for in the next 48 to 72 hours in South America is a noteworthy earthquake above 5.9, below 6.5. Now, the reason I'm putting it at that level is because, first of all, the round of deep earthquakes over here is going to cause at least a 5. Then you'll have to take into account the multiple eruptions and the previous deep earthquake and the earthquakes to the north. If you take that all into account, it's pretty simple. The spot in the middle, in between the two sets of earthquakes here in South America at the Ecuador border, need to be warned now because it's going to be large. As we get into United States, well, that 4.0 activity today has resulted in certainly what we would expect to see happen as the first wave of energy travels across the plate. The Colorado fracking operations, the Oklahoma fracking operations, the Southern California pumping operations all got hit. Now, which one do you want to see first? How about the Colorado? Let's go look up Colorado. 2.6 Rangeley, Colorado. Now, you guys know I lived out in Colorado for several years and, really love to get outdoors. Unfortunately, what they're doing here, let me just show you. Picture speaks a thousand words. I'm not going off on the oil companies. The only reason there's even this location's even being struck at all is because the geologist provided bad information to the oil companies and didn't give them the appropriate warning or didn't let them know that their operations stand to be vulnerable when pressure is introduced on the West Coast. These are fracking ops here where they do wastewater disposal. They'll pump wastewater down into the ground, chemical-laden water. That water then fractures the shale. They extract the gas. And this looks like a fairly sizable operation going down this road. But let me show you a bigger operation up here to the north. Now, it might just look like a... See my place marks here? I got tired of marking them because every single one of these little pads here is a different frac op. Okay, so they're kind of low resolution, but every little circle pad here is a different one. And they're connected by pipelines, and then you can start to see it goes on for many miles in all directions. So Northwest Colorado hit. We warned Colorado for this week in case you guys missed the warning. We issued a warning for Colorado along the Craton Edge when we talked about the earthquakes up in Yellowstone, up in Wyoming. So now let's take a look at Oklahoma. Drumright, Oklahoma. Okay, never heard of Drumright before. It's a new location. Let's see what's there. I already know what's there, but let's show new viewers. Okay, here we are, zooming in on the location, and what do we have right next? First of all, I think right next to it is this one right here. Looks like it. Looks like an old one with some kind of pipeline stretched out across there. Maybe we've got a closer one that we can give you a better view on. Here's one that's newer. Okay, it's still kind of nasty. Look, they even have some black out there. There's been some spillage or something. Knocked over tanks there. Look at that. Wonderful. Okay. Anyways, fracking operation, a spot where they've drilled down into the crust, and they're all over the place out here, guys. That's not the only one. Every single one of these little pads is a different frack op as well. You can even make out the oil here. Oh, yeah. You can see the shadow on the pump there. Right there. See that? Anyways, vulnerable only when pressure is coming across the coast. From the West Coast to the East Coast. Now down in Southern California, let's open this one up. See this 2.0? Okay, Santa Barbara Channel, California. All right, well, let's go ahead and get our coordinates just like all the others. Put them in and go look them up. And then I'll show you the other ones. So these aren't the only earthquakes of the day, but these are the ones that struck the pumping operations as expected. Here we go. All right, back to the same location. Here's our offshore oil rig right here. So offshore, we always look within 6 to 10 miles like the USGS. And there's our offshore oil rig right up the coast right there. And then our pumping operation continues over to the east and then goes on to land. Here, I showed that last night. Every single one of these is a different oil well pumping operation. Okay, so you start to get the picture? Okay, the pumping operations show activity when pressure is introduced from the west coast. And where did pressure come from? How about a series of fours? Series of fours over the past couple days up here to the west-northwest. This is going to cause a four down in Southern California within the next day to 2 days at the most. 48 hours at this point, most likely. Within 48 hours, we should be seeing a 4.0 striking near Los Angeles at the pumping operations. Okay? Just be aware that's getting ready to happen. Don't be too alarmed when a 4 hits in Southern California. Additionally, there's going to be new swarm activity. Let's get that open and show you what's hit. So today, we told you there was going to be an increase in swarm activity going down Southern California and especially its Central California. And take a look at it. Mammoth Mountain, Aurora Crater, Aurora Peak, Long Valley Caldera, going over to the nuclear test sites. All hit with swarms, and now we're swarming at the nuke test site, guys. Swarming. So it went from zeros, you know, a couple of zeros, to now a swarm. Well, there's no shock in there. Okay, don't be alarmed. We're not seeing nuke tests happen there. It's only a result of the pressure inundating the entire area. It's absorbing it like a sponge right now. Once it gets fully inundated, once it's fully absorbed, the pressure will finally release with a single similar-sized earthquake than what struck off the coast yesterday. So if it's a 4.1 up to the northwest, then it's going to be about a 4 down to the south. And it's going to be about a 4 or near 4 in the Midwest. It's already increasing in the Midwest, and it's already increasing down to the south on day 1 of what we're watching for. Now, let's jump over and go to the slow slip tremor page. See what's going on today. See if anything has changed over the last 24 hours compared to last night. And what we're going to see here, oh, well, look at this. The swarm up in Vancouver Island is cut in half, while the swarm down in Oregon has picked up by double. So the earthquake, the pressure alleviated from the north, has immediately slipped to the south. And you can see there's now two clusters of earthquakes at Grants Pass, Oregon. And these are small microquakes, tremors. Grants Pass, Oregon is right in here. Let's turn our borders and labels on so you can see that. Here's Medford and Grants Pass right here. Okay, now let's follow Grants Pass out to sea to the west-northwest. And where does that pick us up with? Well, I'll be. It picks up with the fracture zone that moved with the 4.0 activity this past week. So what's going on here is pressure is spreading itself out from Vancouver all the way down to Oregon and California. A swarm like what just we're looking at here, a swarm just like this, struck in California just last week. Now it's moved again. So the whole region is slow slipping. And we're talking about thousands of earthquakes at this point over 10 weeks' time and 600 miles area. I would say that's going to result in a single larger earthquake larger than what hit in 2012. 2012, October 27th, it was a 7.7 just in the Vancouver Island region, just from Vancouver Island slow slipping. Now it's Vancouver Island, Washington State, Oregon, and Northern California that slow slipped, and it's gone on for twice as long as the Vancouver event in 2012. So does that mean we're looking at double the earthquake of a 7.7? A 7.7 plus a 7.7 takes us to 7.87 or 7.9. So if you add two 7.7s together, that gets us to almost 8.0, guys. What does that mean? Well, it means that we have to watch for the additional pressure to break free in the next few weeks if the slow slip event suddenly stops. If the slow slip event suddenly stops, then that's when we look for a large earthquake. But we already are looking for a large earthquake because the professionals told us to over the past several months with their big article that they released telling everybody a big 9.0 was going to be coming to the Cascadia subduction zone. The Cascadia subduction zone about 50 miles offshore, and we talk about the Juan de Fuca about 200 miles offshore. We're in two separate areas, both part of the same region. I would say if we're going to see a large earthquake strike, it would strike out here, several hundred miles offshore. So the shaking damage from the earthquake wouldn't be that great. And the wave from a 7.8 to 7.9, while it could be somewhat significant, wouldn't be on that Japan level. It would be more on a smaller wave, more like a storm surge that would be coming in. But it's still significant. Now, if I'm wrong and it strikes 50 miles offshore as opposed to 200 to 300 miles, you will feel it majorly. And it will cause a wave that will cause damage if it's that close. But I'm leaning towards off-sea. Why am I leaning towards offshore? Well, take a look at it, guys. That's the spot that's been hit over and over and over again every time new pressure is introduced or a slow slip happens. Make note of the dates here. June 2015. Gee, that's ironic because June and July of 2015, their biggest earthquakes in years struck out here. And it's coming into that time of year again. I told you guys that at the winter time, at Christmas, we start to see an increase in earthquakes once we're nearing that winter solstice time. And once we get into summer and we start nearing the summer solstice, we start to see the increase in large earthquakes. There is a relation to that. The reason that's happening is because the core of the Earth and the planet itself is turning. It's literally turning physically. And that's causing a disturbance and it's causing earthquakes. And it happens on a seasonal basis. It explains why the Boxing Day earthquake happened. It explains why we saw the Easter earthquake happen. It explains why we see these equinoxial earthquakes happen. Okay, pretty interesting, right? Okay, that being said, we need to take a look off the West Coast overall, again, for other activity, not just related to the slow slip. Because we have this new deep earthquake event, let's get that back on the screen, you're going to get hit by a double whammy. Regardless of the slow slip, you're going to get hit again West Coast. So where are you going to get hit? Most likely in between where your previous fours struck. But like I told you guys, this week is going to be pretty significant. It's going to be going everywhere where there were fours, there's going to be fives, at least one. So, and everywhere where there are fives, there are going to be sixes. That's already started to happen at Mexico. There were, you know, last week there were fours, now there are upper fives near six. So on the West Coast, where I want you to watch, past Northern California into the coast of Oregon, I want you to watch for up to a five to strike, one full magnitude larger than the fours we currently saw this past week. Okay, time frame on that. Today's the 20th. We're going to have to look for the next 5 days. So that's going to put us at, let's see, 21st, 22nd, 23rd. By the 24th into the 25th, this should have all played out on the West Coast of the United States, a new five. And that will dramatically re-increase things for the fracking operations, and it will cause a new upper 4 to 5.0 earthquake in Southern California by start of next week. So I'm not trying to get too far ahead of myself, but with this amount of deep earthquakes, I can already tell you, we're looking at a dramatic increase around the entire plate, not just over here in the West Pacific. Speaking of dramatic increases versus decreases, here in Japan, look at this. Okay, we went, 8 days without any real reported earthquakes here off the coast of Japan, and then finally it gets hit, and where does it get hit? 5.0 on the coast of Honshu. So I'm wondering, is it really a 5.0? Is it? I mean, we have to take their word for it. I'm not trying to doubt their word. I just wonder what the other stations show. Is it a 4 like they're saying, or is it something greater? Well, I look at it and I see 5, 5.3s on the list, 5.1s, 5.6 on the list. Keep going down. We got a 5.5, 5.4, 5.1, 5.4. To me, it looks more like a mid-range 5. To me, personally, just looking at the station list. So if I see a mid-range 5 and I'm looking for a mid-range 6 to hit, that's within one magnitude. But they do this lowball thing, all of a sudden it's a miss for me. So if I go with their magnitudes, it's a miss. If I go with the stations that are showing mid-range 5, then it's within a magnitude of what we're looking for. So is it a hit or is it a miss? I'm going to go ahead and call it a miss. Why? It took too long. It took too long and it's not as big as we were looking for. So that being said, the earthquake that we were looking for to strike on the coast of Honshu in between Honshu and Hokkaido has struck, but it was just a mid-range 5, one magnitude less than what I was looking for. I was looking for mid-range 6 to 6.8, okay? I guess that's good news, right? I mean, I guess we can beat me up, right? It's okay, beat me up. It's better for me to get beat up than for, you know, me to be wrong and, you know, not warn you and then something hits, right? So, what's going to hit next? Now that we're talking about this location seeing pressure relieved, and also we have to take into account the Kuril Islands were also struck with a 5. Let's go see that. Hold on one second. Let's go see what that was. Maybe that was also mid-range 5. Hold on. 5.2, 5.7. It is like the exact same earthquake. Look, 5.7, mid-range 5s, 5.6, 5.6. They got some 4s on there, but that drags it down. But it's starting to look more like it's a mid-range 5 as well. Ha! Look how many more stations are weighing in on that. Look at this. So a lot of 5.6 is detected. All right. Well, let's just say this one's a 5.5 as well. If this is a 5.5 on the coast of Japan, and this is a 5.5 in the Kuril Islands, like I just showed you, add the two 5.5 together, that takes us to 5.65 or 5.7. And then that's exactly one magnitude less than what we're looking for, and it's an earthquake forecast hit, not a miss. And that matters to me. Did I hit it or did I miss it? In this case, I think we hit it, but we are off by a magnitude. But it's a miss because it took too long. Doesn't matter if I hit it or miss it, there's the earthquake, right? So as we get down further to the south, that's the spot where we're watching. Let's go back over and consult the volcanic ash advisory feed again, see how many times, or if it is even on the list. Is Sakurajima on the list for today? Do we see Sakurajima on the list today? If it's not on the list, that means there's a coming earthquake. Nope, not on the list for today. Okay, Sakurajima did not erupt today. Which means Kyushu, South Japan, north of Taiwan, you guys, check it out. You are sandwiched in between major activity on all sides. Sakurajima blew at least 10 or 15 times in the last week. That alone, if you add that together with the fact that it's a middle silent zone, you're going to have to look out from Kyushu to Okinawa. Let's show you where Okinawa is. Here's the little tiny island of Okinawa. We've got a military base there. And then Kyushu, the greater island that fractured last year, well, in between that spot, it's our halfway point between our two zones. We also have an earthquake over to the east, a deep 4.6. Now, magnitude on this, we have the 5.9 to the south. This means 6.9 to 7.9 is potential in South Japan. Okay, deep earthquake down to your south means north of Taiwan, in the silent zone, here is where we're going to have to watch for it, guys. I hate to break it to you. I mean, I hate to have to issue this warning for Kyushu. Since the north has been hit, that means we can only hope for less. Hope that what happened to the north happens down here to the south. That it's shallower movement and that it stays in swarms as opposed to, or you know, multiple fives or something hit as opposed to a single larger earthquake. It's going to strike in the middle of the silent zone, okay? And that goes into Kyushu. Let's see, dutchsinse. New Zealand had 2.4s, South Island, same place this morning and this evening. I love it, man, I love it. Have they had over 150 earthquakes today? Is this over 150? Because here, let's see. Where are the 4s? Where's GeoNet's 4s? Here's the north part. They got the 4 from the 19th. So where are the 4s on the north and south part of the island today? What is going on? Why is GeoNet not have them? It should be on their feed. I'm looking at the last 150 earthquakes from GeoNet. Are they just taking earthquakes off their feed? Because there's the 4 of the 3.9. But where are the others? It's a good question. It's a really good question. Why do they take them off? Why are they not reporting them? Why do they reduce them or make them something else? Are these the earthquakes that they were? Were they 4s and they take them down to 3.7 and 3.9? Is that what happened? See, I mean, it's a full-time job just to monitor New Zealand itself, to keep track of each earthquake and whether or not they were upgraded or downgraded or show or don't show. It's insane. Two were in the same place. Two were in the same place. Yeah, I mean, there you go, right there. I mean, which place? Where? Where were they on the South Island? Damn it, I want to know. Oh, it doesn't matter. It's a 4, but it's the 4s are a result of your deep earthquakes up to your north. I mean, you guys know this. Deep earthquakes to your north means 4 on the South Island. Oh, a 4 just happened? Is that what you're saying? Because this shows their most current. Here, like 2.5 just popped on the list. It's from 4 UTC. 4 UTC. And it's 4:05 UTC. So it's not that I'm getting earthquakes late. Here's the most recent right here. 4 UTC. I get them every 5 minutes. So where are they? Why is it not on their international feed? Why do they take it off? Why do they have it on their website but not on their RSS feed? What they're doing, guys, is New Zealand is literally removing them or not putting them on their international RSS feed, but they are listing them on their website. That's amazing. You know? Because if you're an international viewer and you're tuning in to get the information, you got an RSS feed that they provide to you, you'd think it would show it. But go open your own copy of Earthquake 3D. You know what I mean? So how could I be missing earthquakes from 4 hours ago or 5 hours ago or whatever when I've got the most recent here on the screen right now? And we can take it back and look at the second most recent. 3.9 was at 001 UTC. That's really crazy. Let's hit refresh. That's 4 hours difference. That's 4 hours difference. The last 4 hours is missing from the New Zealand feed. This one shows 001 UTC, 1 minute after. That's 4 hours ago. It's 407 UTC now. So where's the last 4 hours worth of earthquakes on their feed, guys? Huh? Good question. It's a good question. It looks like somebody's trying to hide something. Or maybe a technical error. Maybe there's a technical error. That's also something possible, that there could be a technical reason. Maybe they were down for the last 4 hours on their RSS feed or something, right? Working on our RSS feed to make it better. Could be. Could be. I'm sarcastic and I'm skeptical and I'm a little bit paranoid, but that's okay. That's what a scientist is. Just ask Bill Nye. All right. So have a plan. Be prepared. The only spots that we really need to talk about still are the spots that haven't been hit yet. Let's talk about that. Let's just move on. We'll move on from the earthquakes that have struck. Let's talk about the spots that we're looking for activity. Let's briefly recap for everybody here who's listening. We're looking in South America. We're looking at the Ecuador-Peru border, and we're going to be taking that up to the near 6.0 level at this point. We're also looking over in the Caribbean, over next to, we're going to have to encompass in Haiti, Dominican Republic. At this point, how many earthquakes have struck? None. Again, we're back to none. Somebody just posted something saying Barbados got hit. I wouldn't be surprised at that. I really wouldn't. We're looking for the Caribbean to get hit, so if it did get hit, I'm not surprised. If it hit Barbados, I would be a little bit more eyebrows raised because that skipped over the whole area again. Oh, what else? We need to watch our silent zone here in the Gulf of California, since we're going to watch Southern California for a 4 here, and you have a 5.7 to your south. Guess what that's going to do? That's going to sandwich into the Gulf of California, and you'll see a new earthquake strike here. Probably will be a little less than the 5.7 or 5.8 to your south. So maybe mid-range 5. It'll lose a little steam trying to come up this way. You see which way the arrows point? So the arrows point in the opposite direction. Got another big storm blowing in right now. And so, anyways, that's the halfway point. Watch for the mid-range 5 to strike, so it'll be a few points less than the 5.8 to your south. Overseas, over in our silent zone next to our deep earthquakes, we have a building threat here in the Solomon Islands, west of our letter D at our triangular bend. There's 3 different deep earthquakes, 4.6, 4.4, and 4.4. If you add the 4.6 plus 4.4, that takes us to 4.74, or almost a 4.8. Then you add in another 4.4, and that takes us to 4.94, or almost a 5. So we're looking at basically a deep 5's worth of energy here in the past 24 hours, which means a shallow 6 is likely, maybe even larger, but we'll put it at 6, striking back into the Solomon Islands. Now, that's not that big of a deal. It already happened once this past week. Let me show it to you. Here's the 6.0 that already hit. So we're going to have another one. It's based upon the new round of deep earthquakes. But that's on top of what we're already looking for yesterday's deep. The deep 6.0? So if we're adding a 6 on top of the 7, my God, this is getting to be a cluster.
If we're adding the 6 on top of the 7, then we're already going to 7.1, and I'm actually looking for it to possibly even go larger because it's such a deep earthquake here in the Philippines. This takes us back into eastern Papua New Guinea and the Solomon Islands for the combination of a 6 could strike separately from the 7, or it could be the 6 and the 7 add together at the same time. They're within 24 hours of each other. So in other words, we've got two deep earthquakes on both sides. You see them raised high on the globe? And you see the middle point here? The middle point between the two deep earthquakes is going to be hit. And it's going to be hit by a combination between the two. So it could be, again, like I said, it could be the one large earthquake from the first 5.9 followed immediately in a separate location close by a 6. That wouldn't be too big of a shock. Or they could combine together and go into one single larger earthquake. I mean, which would you rather have? It's not going to make that much of a difference. It's going to be within a few points of each other, but it's going to be here. I'm going to get you dizzy looking at the screen so you'll remember it. Okay, and Japan. Let's go back over Japan one more time. We're looking at Okinawa to South Kyushu. And we have to look for up to 1 to 2 magnitudes larger as well, 6.9 to 7.9, to be striking here. Yes, 6.9 to 7.9 Kyushu next set, five days. Next 5 days. As we go further to the west, we're going to have to watch for this to creep around, all these earthquakes here, to creep around and go out towards Europe. So within the next 5 days, this whole area across Myanmar, across Nepal, all the locations that we would normally name, well, those are all going to be hit again, but most likely first at the central fulcrum point. Central fulcrum point of what? We have to look between the volcano here, where the letter V is, and the previous earthquakes down here to the east. So, halfway point between the letter V and the earthquakes to the east obviously brings us into Krakatoa volcano here at the bay. So Krakatoa, the famous volcano there, halfway point between Sinabung and the earthquakes to the east. Add up all the earthquakes to the east, all these shallow earthquakes. So what do we got? We got a 5 and some 4s. Add those together. That's already going to put us into the 5.3, 5.4 range to be striking right here at Krakatoa. Add in, let's see, Sinabung, how many blasts? 2 blasts? It might take it up another point, maybe 5.5. We'll just call it a 5.4 at Krakatoa for right now. 48 hours. Not long, guys. 2 days. Furthermore, to the west, between Sinabung, where the letter V is, and the other set of earthquakes over at India, what's our halfway point? Brings us right back in on where the previous earthquake struck, at the China-Myanmar-India border region right here where our arrow is. But this time it's going to be a combination of two different blasts down to the south and the 4s over to the west. That's going to be in the 5.2 range, guys. It'll be in the 5 range for sure right here at the Myanmar-China border region. Time frame, 48 to 72 hours at the most. Once the 5 hits over here, it's going to re-excite things back for Afghanistan and Pakistan, and we'll see a new 5 strike back at the letter D. Maybe even a new deep earthquake, since we're going through a deep earthquake event right now around the planet. I mean, it's not like there's just one location that's swarming. We may see a new deep earthquake here, which will then dramatically re-excite things back up. And I'll be on tomorrow night talking about a Mideast warning as opposed to just watching the current earthquakes going across the region. Finally, this brings us back into Europe. Take all the earthquakes, add them together at this point, and we have to watch to the west. Where to the west? Well, take a look at it, guys. Greece has gone quiet. Greece went silent. That's abnormal with all the activity over to the east, all those 4s, and now Greece is just magically no earthquakes? Did they turn off all the seismometers in the entire region? I don't think so. It's gone quiet earthquake-wise, which means there's going to be an earthquake in Greece very soon, a combined total of everything over to your east. And let's get a total. Let's tally it up. How many 4s are there? Well, let's see. We got a 4.2 and a 4.1. That equals 4.3. Add in the other 4.1. That equals 4.4. Add in the 4.6. That equals 4.7. And add in the other 4.7 back behind there. That equals 4.9. Add in the other 4s. That equals near 5. So we're talking about a potential energy over the last several days, at least in the 5 to 5.1 range. This means 5.0 activity is getting ready to return to western Greece along with a large swarm. This sounds like an exact repeat of what led up to the August earthquake in Italy that caused 200, 300 people to be killed. But now, the good news for the people in Italy is that you are already fractured. You are already broken. Your plate already moved. So, when new pressure comes in, it doesn't cause that first big impact like was caused originally. But this means things are going to increase in Italy. The swarm is going to go back through the roof. You're probably going to go up to your upper threes again, because you've got a 5.0 energy potential down striking across the entire South Mediterranean. It's going to push your way. Now, there is one saving grace, and that's that the pressure seems to be going to the north and escaping out to Iceland. We warned the area at the North Sea. I don't know if that's been hit or not. They've been known to not report earthquakes out there. I find it highly odd that the 4.0 struck in Romania and then followed with no earthquake activity in between and then popping back up at Iceland. I just really wondered, did the North Sea get hit by something and we just didn't get to hear about it? So if you live in Italy, your good news is that Greece is going to get hit before you. The bad news is once Greece gets hit, then you're back in the mix. And you're back in the mix for the next several weeks after Greece gets hit. It's only a matter of maybe a day, probably by tomorrow. I'd say by tomorrow night. Now, again, it's already the 21st overseas, so really we should say by the 22nd. By the tomorrow overseas time, we should be talking about a 5 in Greece. And then we'll be warning Italy, heads up, it's coming your way. But first things first, Greece is going to be hit, not just anywhere in Greece, western Greece at the Ionia Range, the thing that's blocking all this to begin with. Oh boy, what else just happened? Something just dinged up. Oh, we got a new swarm of earthquakes in Iran at the previous swarm location where the 200 people got injured. Oh boy. All right, guys. So I would like to encourage you to have an earthquake plan and be prepared. Don't be scared by any of this. You can start to actually plot your own earthquakes if you really are an intrepid person. You can make note of where the earthquakes are striking, watch the areas next to where the earthquakes are striking, and find your middle fulcrum point. That will then tell you the next spot to be struck. And if you're really into adding things up, you can start calculating by adding the magnitudes on both sides of the region. And that will give you the rough magnitude of what's going to strike at the middle within the next few days. It plays out across the planet like that in every single silent zone that you see. Only along the plate boundaries. Earthquakes are not random. You know, sometimes Brazil gets struck, but, you know, Brazil doesn't get struck much. You know why? Because it doesn't have a plate boundary going across it. The spots where the plate boundaries are the spots where we see most of the movement occur. The spots that are next to the plate boundaries or attached to the plate boundaries, those spots move proportionate to how much the plate boundary is moving. So, for instance, west coast of the United States, take a look at what's hit over the past few days. Do you see? Do you see this? Do you see how it goes down to a pinnacle or a point over to the east coast? This happens on a weekly basis like this. Pressure loses momentum as it travels across the plate. So a swarm of fours on the west coast can cause a swarm of threes and twos in the Midwest, which can cause twos going up the east coast, and ones all the way up in the northeast. It happens like that over and over again. And the bigger the movement is on the west coast, well, guess what? The bigger the movement is in the Midwest than on the East Coast. So if you live in the Midwest, you got to look to the West Coast. And if you live on the West Coast, you actually have to look to the West Pacific. If you live in the West Pacific, you have to look to your deep earthquakes. And that's the trail that's left by the earthquake activity. Deep earthquakes start. They then push the plate. The plate then starts to move at a shallow level with big, large earthquakes. Those big, large earthquakes then spread out across the plates, pushing the other plates. The other plates then compensate and push over to the east, in this case, the United States, Central America, and South America, pushing to the east. And Asia, also the Indian plate and the Indian Ocean, being pushed to the west. In other words, the planet's being pushed in the opposite direction than we're told. We're told that the mid-Atlantic ridge spreads and pushes the plates apart. That's not the case. The plates are being pressed together. That's why they have the same shape on both sides of the Atlantic, by the way. The fracture zone in the middle is what's causing the shape of the plates, guys. A lot of people like to say South America and Africa look like they fit together. No. They're separated by a huge, vast area that's being pressed together like a sandwich, and that's why they're taking the same shape on both sides. The fracture zone in the middle is that shape. Okay? So, in other words, geology got it fully backwards. The plates are moving in the opposite direction than we're told, and the earthquakes give away that fact. Take that into account, you'll start to understand. Most of geology that made the claim that earthquakes can't be forecast is based upon incorrect dogmas and old ideas from the 1800s. A bunch of old guys who said something couldn't be done. That's it. We don't accept that anymore in science. All right, so use the roadmap and you will start to see the pressure transfer. This big guy over here, this big deep earthquake, the big deep 5.9, that's the one. That's the one that's going to be causing the major activity. This new swarm of deep fours, that's also accompanying it. We are in the middle of a deep earthquake event, like what built up to last December. We are now building up to June. As we go into June, it's going to be the six-month anniversary of the last major earthquake event, which was at the winter solstice. We built up to Christmas Day. On Christmas Day, the 7.9 hit down here in Chile. And just a few days before that, two 7.9s hit at Papua New Guinea and the Solomon Islands. Well, it's going to happen again. And just like back in December, we saw deep 6.0s, deep 5.9s and so forth, and a deep earthquake event happen. Well, now that's happening again. So are you going to be prepared this time? I hope so. And I hope you take it serious. I hope you watch over this week. And I hope you watch the areas that we're talking about now. That you write down the areas, maybe it'd be easier to just listen to me. You actually write down the areas and make note as they get hit. I'll be on every night for the next several nights, talking each day as we start going up and up and up and up and up in magnitudes. It's not going to go down. It's going to go up. Like I said, where there were fours, there will be fives. Where there are fives, there will be sixes. Where there are sixes, there will be sevens and greater. So far, it's held true. Fours have turned into fives. Fives have turned into near sixes. So it's day one. We got six more days to go. Really five, if you want to count international, okay? And that's all I've got for you. So thank you, thank you, thank you for tuning in tonight. I am sorry we got to such a weird start. It just happens sometimes, I suppose. And now things are doing much better, so I appreciate you guys sticking in. I want to thank all my Patreon supporters. I want to thank everybody who's super chatted. I want to thank everybody who's donated to my operation. You've made it so I can be here every day and every night. And, you know, again, I had my choice. I could go cut down trees and do carpentry, or I could do earthquake forecasting. You guys told me to stay, and you would help. That's the best I could do. Thank you for making it possible. Thank you. All right, and last night, we didn't do our unboxing. I apologize for that. We had some other stuff going on, and we'll probably be getting into that, I'd say, tomorrow, just because... Oh, man, I don't know. Maybe I will do it tonight. I think I need to, like, have a mood picker-upper at some point. Today was kind of a downer for me. So maybe I will. You know what? I'll see how I feel in an hour. If you want to stick around till like 12:30, jump back in or see if I'm in here. And if I'm in here with the camera on, then I'll be opening up some viewer mail, and we'll get to that. I do have a bunch of beer. Man, I got a bunch of beer. But I don't like drinking when I feel down. I don't know. Some people love drinking when they feel down. They're like, give me a bottle, I'm going to get my groove on. I don't know. What else is happening? I think that's it. Tat's in here. Hey, everybody, say what's up to Tat. And you need to go over to his page and subscribe. Definitely go over, subscribe, and give him a shout out, guys. Tat is trying to get his live stream going after that shutdown. You guys know they hit him with this false shutdown crap. I don't even know what's going on, man. It doesn't even make sense. And they shut him down. And now he's like, okay, screw it, man. I'm turning my live stream back on. And I encourage you guys, just go over there and hang out. Maybe leave it open so he gets some credit for having it there. He needs to build the audience. And we're trying to figure out the right... He's got the Oroville Dam going and some stuff on the Constitution. And we're trying to find something that can just be a steady thing that he can do for each day on the live stream. I don't know. If you guys got ideas, shoot them over to me or something. If you guys want to see something on a live stream, like weather or solar or whatever. We already tried doing the solar, and nobody wanted it. We found out, Tat did the experiment. We found out that nobody gives two craps about solar, and that the whole solar crowd on YouTube's fake. Or most of it. We're like, what? We started a live stream to show solar activity nonstop 24/7. It had one viewer. One viewer live nonstop 24/7. And I'm like, what the hell is this? Tat's like, I'm getting censored. I'm like, no, dude, I don't think anybody gives a shit about solar information. I think we've been presented a false narrative on YouTube that people care about solar information for some reason. Oh, man. Anyways. So, yeah, if you want to jump over there and check it out, that would be appreciated. I know he'd appreciate it. He didn't put me up to this. I'm just saying it. So, all right, guys. Word up. Peace out. Much love. I'm done.